الحمد لله رب العالمين ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ولي الصالحين ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له هو الأول والآخر هو الظاهر والباطن وهو بكل شيء عليم ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وحبيبه إمام المرسلين وصفوة خلق الله والناس أجمعين ورضي الله تبارك وتعالى عن الصحابة المكرمين وعن التابعين وتابع التابعين إلى يوم الدين أما بعد عباد الله اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا واذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ كنتم أعداء فألف بين قلوبكم فأصبحتم بنعمته إخوانا. Dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. And all praise are due to Allah, and we bear witness that there is no God but Allah. Muhammad is His servant and messenger. Peace, blessing, and mercy of Allah be upon him, and upon the prophets before Prophet Muhammad, and the followers until the day of judgment. Dear brothers and sisters, today inshallah we will be talking about one of the hadith Qudsi, narrated by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And before we start talking about the hadith Qudsi, I like to define the hadith Qudsi and compare it with the hadith Sharif so you do not get confused in between. The knowledge which we are receiving in this religion came through first the Holy Quran, then the Hadith Qudsi, then the Hadith Sharif. And I'd like to give you some differences in between so you be with me all the time inshallah. The Holy Quran came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, words and meaning. So we cannot change anything from the Holy Quran. Not even a word with another word that equal to the same meaning. That's the Quran, came as it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second was the Hadith Qudsi. Hadith Qudsi, the meaning came to the Prophet from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the wordings are the wordings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Rasulullah will say, Allah has said in the Hadith. Means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala either inspired into the heart of Rasulullah with something, or showed him that in his vision, and Rasulullah understood the meaning which was meant by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and interpreted to us by his own words, and that called Hadith Qudsi. You hear that a lot. Allah said in the Hadith Qudsi. It's different than Allah said in the Quran. Allah said in the Quran means we cannot change anything from the words. Can we change a word from the Hadith Qudsi? Yes, you can if you forgot the original words that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said and you know the exact meaning of that Hadith. The third one is the Hadith Sharif. The words and the meanings are from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Can we hear the Hadith and understand the Hadith and narrate it by our own language? Once in a while, a word dropped and you put another word with the same meaning based to your own understanding? Yes, you can, provided that you already forgotten the word of Rasulullah. You cannot take intentionally a word from Rasulullah and put your own word. It does not work. Unless you forgot and you understand the exact meaning, you can say Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said what it means, and you can say what you understood from that hadith. So now we know the Quran, Hadith Qudsi, and Hadith Sharif. The hadith which we are talking about today is a Hadith Qudsi. And this hadith have lots of knowledge and hits many areas in our life. That's why I want each and every one of us to take what concern him and try to adjust his life based on the commandments of Allah and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يا عبادي إني حرمت الظلم على نفسي وجعلته بينكم محرما فلا تظالموا. يا عبادي كلكم ضال إلا من هديته فاستهدوني أهدكم. يا عبادي كلكم جائع إلا من أطعمته فاستطعموني أطعمكم. يا عبادي كلكم عار إلا من كسوته فاستكسوني أكسكم. يا عبادي لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم جاءوا على أتقى قلب رجل واحد منكم ما زاد ذلك في ملكي شيئا. يا عبادي لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم جاءوا على أفجر قلب رجل واحد منكم ما نقص ذلك من ملكي شيئا. يا عبادي لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم وقفوا جميعا في صعيد واحد وسألني كل واحد مسألته لأعطينهم جميعا ولا ينقص ذلك من ملكي شيئا إلا كما ينقص المخيط البحر إذا أغمد فيه. يا عبادي إنكم لن تبلغوا نفعي فتنفعوني ولن تبلغوا ضري فتضروني. يا عبادي إنما هي أعمالكم أحصيها لكم ثم أوفيكم إياها أي يوم القيامة، فمن وجد خيرا فليحمد الله ومن وجد غير ذلك فلا يلومن إلا نفسه. Dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in this hadith, O my servant, I have made oppression forbidden on myself, and I made it forbidden amongst you. So oppress not one another. This is the first portion of the hadith, talking about oppression, dhulm. And you and me may practice that dhulm once in a while. And today we will talk, this is the first portion of that hadith, and that will have a big, great subject, and that subject is the dhulm, the oppression, and the opposite of that is the justice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started first by himself, saying that oppression is forbidden on myself. So you should not oppress one another. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not oppress anyone. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not even judge us by his justice. If he does, we all will lose. What do you mean? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us everything we have. Everything we had in the past. And everything we are dreaming to have in the future. What do you give Allah in return? What do you give him in return? Can you count that with justice and see if you are really just with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When you are just with me, I sell you something that's worth $1,000, you give me $1,000. If you give me less than that, you are unjust. If you give me more than that, you are kind and generous. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you everything you have. What do you give Allah in return? And that which you give Allah in return, is it really equal to compensate Allah for what he has given you? There was narrated that a man will come in the day of judgment, worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for 500 years. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will order the angels to take him to the Jannah by the mercy of Allah. This man doesn't like it. What are you talking about? The mercy of Allah. I was worshipping Allah for 500 years. I like to go to the Jannah by my deeds. So Allah will bring him back and they will make some calculations. And to see what he has offered to Allah in return to that which Allah has given him. They found that all the worship of 500 years is less than the blessings of his vision. Less than the blessings of his being able to see. Then Allah will tell the angels, take him to the hellfire by my justice. Then the man will cry again, asking for the mercy of Allah. Then Allah will readmit him to the Jannah by his mercy. So when you talk about oppression, I would like to talk about three kinds of oppression today. Number one, oppression against your own self. You are the one who oppress yourself. And the second one, the oppression that we practice in our relationship with Allah. And the third and most important one is the oppression of one another. When you oppress your brother, your sister, your wife, your children, your nation, your workers. And this is the worst one. Number one, oppression against your own self. Many of us are not really fair with their own self. They work harder than they should. They are not enjoying their life as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them in the Quran, وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ. Some of us are working more than what they should, are stressed in this life more than they should. So they really are not enjoying what Allah allowed them to enjoy in this life. And also by the other hand, some of us are putting their life in a risk when it comes to the hereafter. They are not doing enough to go to the Jannah. So in the Day of Judgment, they cause themselves to go to the hellfire or face lots of hardship they could avoid if they want. So this is the oppression against yourself. Do not oppress your own self. Be fair with yourself in this life. Be fair with yourself when it relates to the hereafter and the result of this life in the hereafter. Be sure. Be sure to do your best to go to the Jannah, inshallah, to avoid oppressing yourself, because oppression is a great sin, even if it is against your own self. Number two is the oppression in your relationship with Allah. We mentioned a little bit of that area when we say that Allah is always giving you and you are the one that He's always taking. There is the relationship that is not just. You always take and He always gives. Most of the time you are bad and He's good to you. As He said, خَيْرِ إِلَيْكَ نَازِلْ وَشَرُّكَ إِلَيَّ صَعْ. So we have to be fair when it comes to that relationship. The third one is the oppression of one another. And the worst area of that oppression, the oppression of the strong against the weak, of the leaders against the followers. اليوم إن شاء الله نتحدث عن موضوع ينال كل واحد منا جانبا منه. هذا الموضوع جاء في حديث قدسي وشرحنا معنى الحديث القدسي. قد يختلط على بعضنا الحديث القدسي والحديث الشريف. قلنا أن القرآن جاء من عند الله قولا ومعنى، لا يستطيع أحدا أو أحد أن يغير شيئا من القرآن ولو حرفا واحدا، ولو حرفا واحدا أو كلمة بنفس المعنى، لأن الكلام والمعنى من الله سبحانه وتعالى. أما الحديث القدسي فالكلام المعنى من الله والكلام من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، كأن يوحي الله إلى قلب رسول الله أن يقول شيئا أو يفعل شيئا بإذن الله أو باسم الله، أو يريه شيئا في المنام فيقوم في الصباح ويعبر ما فهمه من الله بكلامه هو بأسلوبه هو. لذلك تسمع أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يروي عن ربه في الحديث القدسي كذا وكذا وكذا. فالمعنى من الله في الحديث القدسي والكلام كلام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. قد يسأل سائل، هل لابد أن أحفظ الحديث القدسي كما أحفظ القرآن؟ أقول ليس كذلك بالضبط. ربما تنسى كلمة من الحديث القدسي ولكنك تفهم المعنى فتضيف كلمة من معلوماتك بنفس المعنى، يجوز ذلك بشرط أن تكون بالفعل ناسيا لنفس اللفظ الذي تكلم به رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، وتكون مدركا بالضبط معنى الحديث فتقول يقول رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فيما يرويه عن ربه في الحديث القدسي أن الله سبحانه وتعالى قال كذا وكذا، وليس بالضبط كما تقول القرآن. لا بد أن يحفظ القرآن كما هو. أما الحديث القدسي ففيه شيء من المرونة ولا يتساوى في منزلته مع القرآن الكريم. الحديث الشريف الكلام اللفظ والمعنى من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، وأعتقد هذا سهل وميسور أن ندرك معنى. يقول رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فيما يرويه عن ربه في الحديث القدسي، يا عبادي إن الله حرم إني حرمت الظلم على نفسي وجعلته بينكم محرما فلا تظالموا. إن الله سبحانه وتعالى يبدأ بنفسه في تحريم الظلم على نفسه حتى يكون أسوة وقدوة، رغم أنه ليس منا، ورغم أنه ليس كشخص منا، فليس كمثله شيء، وهو السميع العليم. يبدأ الله بنفسه بتحريم الظلم. ولا نقول أن الله سبحانه وتعالى دائما يحكم بالعدل، ولكنه يحكم بالرحمة. فلو حاكمنا بالعدل دائما لخسرنا جميعا، لأن الله دائما هو المعطي ونحن دائما الآخذون. الله دائما هو الصالح الذي لا يخطئ في حقنا أبدا، ونحن للأسف نخطئ في جنب الله كثيرا. فالعلاقة التي بيننا وبين الله، لو حاكمنا الله بعدله لدخلنا جميعا النار، ولكن الله سبحانه وتعالى يحاكمنا برحمته، فهو الرحمن الرحيم، وهو الذي وسعت رحمته كل شيء. أنواع الظلم ثلاثة، أو على الأقل الثلاثة التي سنتحدث عنها اليوم، هي ظلم النفس، أن تظلم نفسك بنفسك، بأن تحمل نفسك فوق ما تطيق، أو تمنع نفسك مما حلله الله أو أحله الله سبحانه وتعالى لك لتستمتع به في هذه الدنيا. ومن ظلم النفس أيضا ألا ترعى الجانب الديني في حياتك، فستكون النهاية أو العاقبة وخيمة يوم القيامة، وقد تضر بنفسك يوم القيامة. هذا أيضا ظلم للنفس. فالذي يريد العدل مع نفسه أن يعطي نفسه حقها في الدنيا، كما قال الله سبحانه وتعالى: ولا تنس نصيبك من الدنيا وأحسن كما أحسن الله إليك. وأن أيضا يعطي نفسه نصيبها من الآخرة، فيتقي الله ما استطاع، وينتهي عما نهاه عنه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، حتى يكون عنده الأمل والرجاء في أن يدخل الجنة إن شاء الله. أما القسم الثالث وهو أشدها، هو ظلم الآخرين، وتجلى ذلك واضحا في ظلم الحكام للمحكومين. Dear brothers and sisters, when we mention the three kinds of oppression, the oppression against your own self, and the oppression in your relationship with Allah, and the third oppression is the oppression of the strong against the weak, of the leaders against the followers, and this is the worst kind of that. When you commit the sin of oppression against someone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forgive that sin, because it does not relate to Allah. For example, you can do something wrong in your religion, and you make tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah may forgive that sin, because this is all relates to Him. But if you steal $20 from your friend, and you go to Allah, oh Allah, forgive me, Allah is not going to forgive you. This crime, or the crime against other, or against others, have two ways of punishment. One, first, because you violated the law of Allah who said do not oppress. And number two, you violated the law, or you violated the privacy of your brother by taking from him something that does not belong to you. So you need Allah to forgive you, and you need your brother to forgive you. Allah may forget or forgive his side of that, but you need your brother or your sister or whoever you oppressed to forgive you. Otherwise, you will pay him in the day of judgment, inshallah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before his death, he gave us all the guidance that he can give. And he concluded all of this in just one sentence, and said, تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ مَا إِن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِ لَن تَضِلُّوا بَعْدِي أَبَدًا كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَسُنَّتِي. He enjoined into us to follow the book of Allah and the sunnah of him, عليه الصلاة والسلام. Before he died, he knows very much the future of his nation. And he knows that very soon the Sahaba will disagree. The Sahaba will argue with each other. The Sahaba may even fight each other. And you know the fitna, if you study the history of Islam, he knew that the Sahaba are going to be in a trouble with each other. When it comes to the successors after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, some of the Sahaba, or you can say the great majority of the Sahaba, were thinking that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu should be the Khalifa after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you know, he died and did not tell the Sahaba to take Abu Bakr as a Khalifa, or to take Ali radiallahu anhu as a Khalifa. But he gave his own opinion, like he voted indirectly for Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, but did not enforce that into the nation. He wanted them to use their mind. He wanted them to practice what we call today the freedom and democracy of choosing your own people. Some of the Sahaba were thinking that Ali radiallahu anhu may deserve that position, because they looked at it from a different angle. They said Ali is the nearest relative of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ali is the cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ali is the son-in-law of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He married his daughter. And in accordance to the mentality almost of the whole world at that time, the nearest relative inherits that position. But Rasulullah did not tell them, take Ali, because Rasulullah refused to be a king. Because this is the nature of kings. The king dies, his son or his brother takes it over. And the nearest relative of Muhammad was Ali radiallahu anhu. But the party of Rasulullah, Abu Bakr, was the nearest friend of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Was always with him. Just like a president and vice president. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam became very ill, Abu Bakr led the salah instead of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as an imam. Even though Rasulullah did not tell the Sahaba, take Abu Bakr as your leader after me, because he does not want to be a dictator. The dictator's party, the president, when he dies, the next one or the nearest to him or his vice president will take over. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in brief, refused to be a king by allowing Ali radiallahu anhu to inherit the authority and become the leader after him. Refused to be a dictator by enforcing Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu to inherit that position, and he left it for us to choose. And by Allah, you can tell me, especially in the Islamic world, are we led by anyone other than a king or a dictator? Well, Rasulullah refused both. Refused to be king and refused to be a dictator. And our leader's either a king or a dictator. Even when it comes to a king in other countries, the non-Muslim countries, is an honorary position. The king does not rule the nation. The Queen of England does not rule England. The rulers are the Prime Minister and the ministers, and those are from the general public. The Prime Minister is the one that gives the salary to the Queen. She does not assign or say how much she should be getting. They can give her a raise. They can even give her a cut from her salary. But when it comes to our kings, are different. They are not honorary position. They are dictators, in fact. They take every major position of the country has to be occupied by the king, or one of the emirs, or one from the family. You can take, for example, with no offense to anyone, Saudi Arabia. Any major city, the mayor has to be from the ruling family. Any province, the governor has to be from the ruling family. The Air Force, the Navy, the police, everything from the ruling family. So a king, that king and other kings in the Arab world, the king is a king, and he's a dictator as well. When it goes to our dictators, by the other hand, they are not just like any dictators. The dictators have a party, and when the president dies, one from the party becomes the president, and they keep forcing the people to follow their way. But our dictators were unique, were different. everyone preparing his son. And you can see that in the case of Mubarak, his son was ready. Qaddafi, his son was ready. Ali Abdullah Saleh, his son was ready. Al-Assad, his son was ready. Every one of them preparing his son. So that dictator is a dictator trying to be a king. And our kings are kings, but they are dictators. So they are not only either a king or a dictator, but either a king who is a dictator or a dictator who is trying to be a king. Is this the guidance of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who refused to assign Ali because he doesn't want to be a dictator, he doesn't want to be a king, and refused to assign Abu Bakr because he does not want to be a dictator? This is the problem that the Islamic world having today, brothers and sisters. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after following the guidance of Rasulullah, following the directions of Rasulullah, following the Holy Quran, we will know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always fair when it comes to people to people, and is always merciful when it comes from a creator to the creation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala show us the right way and keeps us on it, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on us and admits us to the Jannah by His mercy, inshallah. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم وادعو الله أنتم وكلكم إن شاء الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ولي الصالحين وأن محمدا عبده ورسوله إمام المتقين. لما تحدثنا عن الظلم تحدثنا عن ظلم النفس وتحدثنا عن الظلم في علاقتنا مع الله سبحانه وتعالى وتحدثنا عن ظلم الآخرين وقلنا أنه يتجلى واضحا في ظلم الآخرين ظلم الحكام للمحكومين. قلنا أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قبل أن يموت كان يعرف أن الصحابة سيختلفون، إنهم بشر، منهم من يريد أبو بكر ليكون خليفة لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بما أنه كان الأقرب لرسول الله كصديق وأول من آمن برسول الله من الرجال وواسى رسول الله بماله وبنفسه، فكان هو الأحق من وجهة نظر الغالبية، خصوصا أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أنابه عنه ليؤم الصلاة في مرض رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الأخير. ولكن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أعطى هذه الميزة وهذه الصفة بصفة شخصية فقط، فلم يقل للصحابة اتبعوا أبو بكر بعدي، أو خذوا أبا بكر رئيسا أو حاكما أو إماما بعد رسول الله، ولكن تركها عامة، وكأنه أدلى بصوت واحد، أدلى بصوته كفرد، وترك الأمة تختار من تشاء. كان علي رضي الله عنه أقرب الناس إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، وكان أيضا كفءا لهذا المنصب العظيم، وكان أول من آمن من الأطفال برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لما أصبح الرسول نبيا، وكان متزوجا من بنت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وأحب بناته إلى قلبه. فقال بعض الآخرين يعني هذا يستحق أن يخلف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في هذا المنصب. ولكن رسول الله لم يقر عليا حتى لا يكون في سيرة رسول الله شبهة أن يكون ملكا، فدائما أقرب الأقربين من الملك يرث الحكم. ولم يقل للصحابة أن يأخذوا أبا بكر حتى لا تكون في سيرته شبهة ما نسميه الآن بالديكتاتورية، أنه ديكتاتور وحزبه سيتولى الحكم من بعده. فأبى رسول الله أن يكون ملكا وأبى أن يكون ديكتاتورا، ولكنه رضي لهذه الأمة العدل والخير والحق والسماحة، فتركهم يختارون. فرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ترك هذه الأمة لتتعلم هذه الحقوق. وأرى أن الوقت يداهمنا إن شاء الله، فسنكمل الحديث ومرة أخرى إن شاء الله سنتحدث باستفاضة في هذا الموضوع الذي يخص الكثيرين منا ويرى كل منا فيه ضالته، حيث أننا نتعامل مع الناس فيجب أن يكون بالعدل، نتعامل مع الزوجات، مع الأولاد، مع العمال في في مع في يعني في أعمالنا مع الأصدقاء، ويجب علينا دائما أن نتحرى العدل. وسأتلو عليكم ما تبقى من الحديث حتى يعني نأخذ منه الكم الأكبر أو الحد الأعلى منه إن شاء الله، عسى الله أن يهدينا به إلى ما يحب ويرضى. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في هذا الحديث: يا عبادي كلكم ضال إلا من هديته فاستهدوني أهدكم. يعني لا هداية إلا من الله سبحانه وتعالى. يا عبادي كلكم جائع إلا من أطعمته فاستطعموني أطعمكم. يا عبادي كلكم عار إلا من كسوته فاستكسوني أكسكم. Dear brothers and sisters, we're trying to end our talk today, but the hadith is not yet. So inshallah we will continue that in another day. But I will recite the rest of the hadith to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us enough information from this hadith to lead us in our life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, O my servants, all of you are misguided, misled, except for those who are guided by me. So seek my guidance, I shall guide you. So any guidance other than the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to take you to the right destination. The right destination for you, O Muslim, is to go to the Jannah, inshallah. All of you, O my servants, all of you are hungry, except for those I have fed. What do you mean? All the non-Muslims are eating and eating too much. This is not what it meant in this hadith. The food that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala authorized you is the one that you earn from the halal source, is the one that you give the right of Allah from that risk, that what you eat and Allah approve is the food that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is feeding you. Other than that, you always gonna be hungry. All of you are naked, except for those I have clothed. You can say, what do you mean? I mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala authorize us and enforce on us the dressing code. What you wear, what you do not wear. If you follow that direction, you'll be wearing the clothes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala authorized. So brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also said in this hadith, Ya ibadi, ya ibadi, ya ibadi, law anna awwalakum wa akhirakum wa insakum wa jinnakum جاءوا على أتقى قلب رجل واحد ما زاد ذلك في ملكي شيئا. If all of you, the first of you and the last of you, the human of you and the jinn of you, become as good as the best one of you, that is not going to increase my kingdom anything. يا عبادي, if all of you, the first of you and the last of you, the human of you and the jinn of you, become as bad as the worst one of you, that is not going to reduce my kingdom anything. Oh my servant, you cannot reach the ability to harm me, so you can harm me. Nor can you reach the ability to benefit me, so you may benefit me. Oh my servants, if all of you, the human of you and the jinn of you, the first of you and the last of you, stood all together and asked me all what they want, I will give them all. And that is not going to reduce my kingdom anything more than a needle will reduce the ocean if you dim it and you take it out. Oh my servant, it's only your deeds that I count for you and I assort it for you. If you find good in the day of judgment, so praise Allah for that. And if you find other than that, blame no one but yourself. اللهم أعز الإسلام وأنصر المسلمين وأعل بفضلك كلمتي الحق والدين اللهم زدنا ولا تنقصنا يا رب العالمين اللهم ولي أمورنا خيارنا ولا تولي أمورنا شرارنا ولا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يخافك ولا يرحمنا ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله عظيما اذكركم واستغفروه يغفر لكم وأتوبوا إليه